I just turned on. I don't know if it's you can hear me. Yeah. So as Jacques was saying, yeah, I'm Jonathan Badger, and I'm at the NCI. And what I want to sort of talk to you today is really about three sort of separate topics. One topic is examples of the sort of projects that we're interested in the relation of cancer and immunology to the microbiome. And then after that, I want to talk to you a bit about this pipeline that I'm developing with a colleague at the NCI, which is originally for looking at shotgun metagenomics, but we're extending it into other approaches like transcriptomics as well. So the first project I want to talk about is a project that I did along with Barbara Rehrman and her group that's actually in the National Institute for Diabetes, Digestive Disorders, and Kidney. And what she was interested in is she was concerned that wild mice, or she was concerned that lab mice are not a particularly good model for a lot of the things that she was interested in. And in part, that's because they have a very sheltered life. They aren't exposed to any sort of pathogens. They are basically a very sheltered life. And, you know, ideally you'd say, well, what if we looked at wild mice? But the disadvantage, obviously, of looking at wild mice is that they're obviously genetically quite diverse. So her idea is, what if we took the microbiome from wild mice and transplanted it into lab mice? First of all, the interest is, would the microbiome be preserved? And what would be the effects from the standpoint of immunology? Okay, why can't I see it here? So the first thing what we did is after there was essentially a gavage, so we basically treated the lab mice with antibiotics to basically get rid of their microbiome, and we transplanted the microbiome of the wild mice into these lab mice. And what the first thing is we wanted to do was look and see how do these resulting microbiomes look. And we had several groups. So we have, essentially we have our wild mice themselves. We have what we're calling the wild donor, which are wild mice, but the particular wild mice that we used for the transplants. We have what we're calling wild R. These are lab mice that have been given the wild microbiome. And we have the lab mice. And finally, we have what we're calling lab R. So this is lab mice that have been given the lab microbiome. And you might say, well, what's the point of that? And that's just basically a control to make sure that the transplant process isn't really an issue. And what we're sort of seeing here through this heat map is that you can sort of see where the green and blue, that we're seeing essentially that the wild mice and the lab mice that have been given the wild microbiome sort of cluster over here, and the lab mice and that both the natural lab mice and the lab mice have been given the lab mouse microbiome also cluster over here. So we're seeing a difference in these microbiomes. And when we looked at that, we were sort of saying sort of what are the differences? And the main difference is that we're seeing essentially Helicobacter in the wild microbiome that we're not really seeing in the lab microbiome. And we're also seeing a bunch of unknown species of Bacteroides. And that was sort of interesting because we sort of naturally sort of think as, you know, Helicobacter is sort of, you know, a bad guy. But in some sense, you know, maybe this sort of having the bad guy around actually can help their immune system. And sort of what sort of we looked at to sort of to test this idea is, where's my mouse? So what we did is we essentially infected these mice with influenza. And what we noticed is if you look at this sort of survival curve here, both the lab mice, both the lab mice and the mice that have been given the lab microbiota have poorly react and die. You know, most of them die quite quickly. And if you look at the mice that have been given the wild microbiome, they have a much better chance of survival. And this is, again, sort of showing the same thing, only if you're looking at the actual titer of viruses. Another thing that we looked at was we're looking at how does this affect colon cancer. And there's a model that we can use in mice where essentially we treat mice with some carcinogens to invoke dysbiosis, which tends to encourage the production of tumors. And what we find is that, again, that the mice given the wild microbiome have much fewer tumors in this case than either the lab mice or the mice given the lab microbiome. And these results were published about a year ago in our paper in Cell. Another project I want to talk about is the effect of IL-23 blockade and atherosclerosis, or, you know, the forming of plaques and lesions in the arteries. So IL-23 is a pro-inflammatory cytokine. And cytokines are molecules, if you don't know, which the immune system uses to communicate with other cells. And one of the concerns is that even though this is obviously a useful thing in many cases, it also can be quite detrimental in a lot of autoimmune diseases and cancers. For instance, the skin disorder psoriasis, which is sort of in the news because, you know, famous people like Kim Kardashian and John Lovitz have this disorder. So what people were thinking was, well, what if we could just, you know, blockade IL-23 and this could be a treatment for treating these disorders. But that works, actually. And there's actually a drug on the market called Stelara, which essentially does that. It basically binds to the P40 subunit of IL-23, which then stops it from binding to the receptors and doesn't turn on basically the T helper cell 17. Another issue that sort of, not besides the point, is P40 is actually part of another interleukin called IL-12, but that doesn't really come into the story, but it is a concern. Maybe they need a more specific drug. But there was an issue over whether IL-23 blockade contributes to the plaque buildup. There was some sort of anecdotal issues that some of the people treated with this drug tend to have more heart attacks. And, you know, there's some papers back and forth. Some say, well, that wasn't really statistically significant. And other ones were saying it is. And they're saying, well, there really isn't a mechanism. And the other thing is we noticed there seemed to be a diet difference. I mean, you could say so a lot of these people with the heart problems had sort of a bad diet in addition to taking this drug. So to what level is that involved? And indirectly, to what level is the microbiome involved? So there is a model which our collaborators were the Fox Chase we're using, which is these are mice that have a lipoprotein receptor knockout. And what these mice tend to do is they tend to sort of form plaques naturally. But the question is, we're trying to see, you know, would knocking out IL-23 make them form, you know, more or larger plaques? And in order to do this, we essentially had these, our recipients, which again are these mice that have the lipoprotein receptor knockout, and we transferred the bone marrow where these interleukins are made from A, just wild-type mice as a control. We had also interleukin 23 knockouts, and then we also had a downstream interleukin IL-22, but also again in the inflammation in, pathway. And what we're seeing here is here's sort of basically what you'd expect. Okay, so if you transplant the wild-type bone marrow into these knockout mice, you know, you do form some plaques and lesions. But if you transplant the IL-23 knockouts, then you're seeing, you know, much larger plaques and lesions, and as you can tell here, it's quite significant. And it's sort of repetitive, but we also did it with IL-22. Again, the same principle. You have the knockouts, you have, you know, much more, you know, more lesions. And the question is, you know, we're saying, is the microbiome an effect? And what they sort of first demonstrated this is they basically treated these mice with antibiotic water or regular water. And again, what you're basically seeing here is if you treat with antibiotics, the effect of the lesion, average lesion size is lessened, which suggests that the microbiota is a necessary component to this. And just to sort of follow up on this, then we did also the actual microbiota donation. And again, we basically show that if you transplant the microbiota from these knockouts, again, the number of, you know, the average size of these lesions increases. And then we actually wanted to look at actually some of the bugs themselves. At this point it was just 16S. And basically what they found was, okay, there's a bunch of these bugs, a lot of times these clisterales, you've got morella, and so forth. And what was particularly interesting of these bugs, which they starred for our collaborators, is a lot of these are known to be associated with heart problems. In particular, because they tend to produce this metabolite, which is commonly called TMAO, which is trimethylamine N-oxide. And sort of the follow on this is we actually did some whole shotgun metagenomics. And what we noticed was that there was a lot of these genes in these in our metagenome for TMA lyase, which is an enzyme which converts choline into thymol. And the first time is when we showed this to our collaborators, we're saying, you know, don't take this too seriously because, you know, really what we should have been doing at this point would be metatranscriptomics, because so we could actually show that that this enzyme was being expressed. This was basically showing that a lot of the bugs in these samples had this enzyme, but they went ahead anyway, and it actually was a good guess on their part, because you definitely see that there's much more thymol in the plasma of mice, and they just did it again in both male and female. In this case, there's really no difference, but that's largely becoming sort of standard with a lot of studies, because we're realizing that male and female don't necessarily respond in the same way, so it's always good to look at both. Another thing is what they were noticing was that there is a lot more of LPS. You know, this is basically a product of a lot of bacteria, and they were saying, okay, it looks like there's a lot more bacteria in the serum as well. Wait a minute, did this get off? Hold on 1 second. So I'm not sure if I actually have this, but another thing that they're showing was they're just showing in the gut itself, they were actually looking at just total counts of bacterial 16S. And it was a much larger in the guts for the knockouts than the wild type, which is suggesting that the knockout of IL-22 and IL-23 is actually allowing the gut microbiome to expand sort of unchecked. And sort of finally, last thing is, if they're going to say this is actually the model, you know, can we actually add LPS and thymol and actually get this effect back again, if we're, you know, and as we would if we were actually going to say this is the mechanism? And in fact, we can. We basically, as you can see here, you know, basically if you add LPS and thymol as compared to just the PBS control, you certainly get significantly more, or secondly, longer lesions on average. And finally, what we were saying was a mechanism is, okay, in order, if you're really going to show that this is an effective thing, the sort of the model is that this is causing immune cells to go to the aorta and do damage. And in order to sort of test that, we did just RNA-seq on the aorta tissue, and we were looking for genes which are associated with immune cells. And again, what we're seeing is if you add the LPS and thymol, the expression of these genes is much higher than without. And it's also the case in the blood as well, for at least some of them. So again, sort of what are we getting at? So basically we're saying is, even though you'd say L22 and IL-23 are pro-inflammatory, which in the field we normally think, okay, pro-inflammatory, bad. But they, in this case, they seem to be keeping the intestinal microbiota in check. And a blockade is causing the gut microbiome to expand, which is weakening the epithelial barrier. And this allows the bacteria to escape into the bloodstream, and obviously making their metabolites like LPS and thymol. And this is then attracting monocytes and macrophages into the aorta, which is then actually causing these lesions. So I'm going to sort of shift gears here. So I'm now going to talk about, you know, one of the tools that we're using for actually doing these sorts of analyses. And it's this package that I'm developing with a colleague, John McCulloch, which we're calling JAMS. And sort of as some sort of background in that, it's like, you know, how do we actually know what is in a sample that we're looking at in whole genome, metagenome? And basically, you know, it's a little different than, say, 16S, because in 16S sequencing, you can sort of argue that, you know, the number of reads of each type of 16S is at least proportional to the number of cells. I mean, obviously, if people want to get picky, they could say, well, they are certainly, there are cells that have more than one copy of 16S, which is something I think a lot of pathogens don't consider. But anyway, so if you're looking at just, say, whole shotgun metagenomes, how do you assess what's in your sample? And sort of the analogy we sort of have is, I mean, essentially this is what you're getting out from your sequencing. You just have a bunch of puzzle pieces. And what makes it hard is, it's like a digital puzzle, but like the problem is that there's many different pictures representing different organisms, and then they're obviously in different proportions. Some, you know, bacteria are going to be very common. Some bacteria are going to be very rare. And you're obviously going to be, probably going to be missing some pieces. And you're going to have repeated pieces. And you don't even know, you know, how many pictures there are in your sample, or, you know, whether people have even seen the particular picture. So how people are normally doing this right now is they're doing it through reference-based methods. The classic example is Metaflan. So what they're essentially doing is they're looking for what are called clade-specific genes. So what they're saying is, you know, can we find some pieces which can sort of uniquely identify a picture? So how does this work in practice? So say you have this top piece here. It looks like, I don't know, it's probably a piece of sky. So this isn't going to be informative for telling what your organism is, because it could be many different organisms. Or this dark piece as well. But say, look at this sort of furry piece. Well, okay, so we now know that it's matching one thing. It's matching that kitten. And this works really well, but it's assuming that you have these pictures available. And you can basically say that, you know, the number of hair pictures would be equivalent to the number of kittens you have or something. But, you know, what happens if you have a piece like this? You've never seen a platypus, and you have this platypus part. And what it did in Metaflan, this would just be ignored. And the sort of the philosophy of Metaflan is saying everything that's relevant in your sample is going to be one of the references in the database. And if something isn't mapped, it's probably also something from the ones you have seen. You just couldn't recognize it in that particular case. But that ends up meaning that a lot of times you end up actually throwing out, you know, more data than you're actually classifying. And sort of in order to do this again, we created this pipeline called JAMS, which is sort of cheekily named just another microbiology system. It also happens to be John's initials, John Anthony McCulloch, but he claims that's entirely coincidental. But the basic how we've organized this is in two different parts. We have an alpha part and a beta part. And what we're calling an alpha part is because it's a lot of times it's dealing with alpha diversity, which is what is the diversity of things within your sample. And what you do is it takes in, I'll describe how it works a little bit more, but this is sort of an overview right now. is it takes in your sequencing reads and it basically outputs a file for a particular sample, and we're calling them JAMS files. And what the beta does is it takes in a bunch of JAMS files which represent your samples, and then it has a metadata sheet which sort of explains what each sample is, you know, whether it's healthy, diseased, you know, what have you. And what then, you can then come up with a bunch of comparisons that can then tell you things are significantly more abundant in sort of one type of sample than another. So in order to do this, what we do is we have we need to first taxonomically classify these sequences. And what we're using is a method called Kraken, which essentially is looking for words, which they're calling, you know, k-mers, which are like, in this case, by default, it's, I think it's 31 nucleotides. It's basically saying they've got a database that's already been created, and it says, on average, E. coli tends to have this 31 mer, you know, more than other bugs, so we're going to say this is E. coli. And what's also nice is it gives you a hierarchical result. It doesn't just say that you've got E. coli, because it may say, well, it's probably a proteobacterium, but we don't know which proteobacterium. So it won't over-classify. It'll just say, okay, it's a proteobacterium. But one problem is sometimes people have used these programs like Kraken, and a lot of times they use them directly on reads. And they'll say, well, you know, there's so many things that are unclassified. But we end up actually deciding to do is if you classify assembled contigs, which are much larger than reads, actually the percentage of unclassified things goes quite a bit down. And so what we end up doing is we first assemble the data before we analyze it, and that's basically, we're basically putting together the puzzle pieces. And essentially what we're doing is we consider anything that's over 500 base pairs a contig. We don't throw away the unassembled because sometimes, depending on your depth, you might get quite a lot of unassembled, but we just sort of treat it in a slightly separate, different way. And what we end up doing, we classify as what we're calling a last known taxon. So basically, if it says, you know, it goes down to say proteobacteria, you know, unclassified, then we'll say proteobacteria. We basically just classify to the level that we can. And I don't want to, the reason why I want to sort of describe this sort of the options is not to teach you how to use JAMS, but it sort of is convenient for sort of explaining what JAMS does and what you can use it for. So by default, the sort of the JAMS alpha is taking in some inputs. So by the simplest way is you would provide it a forward and reverse FASTQ. You could also, if you've got some unpaired reads, you could provide some unpaired reads. What's also kind of a neat feature is you can also take in an SRA accession. SRA is a short read archive. It's by NCBI. It has a lot of published data. So if you want to easily analyze some data from a paper that's out there, you can basically just provide the SRA session. It'll download everything and analyze it. You can also just provide already assembled contigs. Sometimes we find that useful because if you already have an assembly, we might want to just sort of feed it in at that standpoint. So another thing you can do is we have this idea of host, because a lot of times when you're analyzing data, you'll get a mixture of the microbiome and the host, a lot of times, you know, mouse or human. And it's not such a big deal when you're working with fecal samples, but a lot of times when you're working with tissue samples, actually the majority of your data might actually be host data. So you want to be able to get rid of that. Another thing is obviously you can type tell what type of sequence it is. I know at some level everyone seems to be doing Illumina, but you know there's still people do PacBio and IonTorrent.
so we support that. And this is what's sort of interesting, is you can specify what type of analysis. Sort of by default, we're just looking at metagenomes. But we're also now allowing you to have transcriptomes. We can have an isolate,
because one of the things we realized is when we were actually doing some whole genome sequencing of bugs that we've isolated from samples, we find a lot of the downstream tools of JAMs are useful. So you can feed it in an isolate.
You can also do, right now, it isn't actually quite working now, is 16S.
And at one level, you might say, well, why do we need to do 16S? Aren't there really some wonderful 16S pipelines out there? There's, you know, Chime and Mother and what have you. And basically, what we're going to do is it's really going to be a wrapper around those things. It's basically, we do that so then we can create a JAMS file for 16S. And what's kind of neat about it is once you have a JAMS file, you could combine it and compare it against, JAMS files that came from metagenomes. Because if you're interested in, say, taxonomy, you don't necessarily care where the taxonomy had come from. So here is the basic workflow. So basically what we do is we have our sequencing reads. We trim the reads with, I think, Trim-O-Matic. We get rid of the host sequences. Again, we assemble de novo assembly, so we end up with a bunch of contigs. We then classify the contigs taxonomically. But then now this is what goes, this is really sort of the helpful part is, okay, you can get taxonomy and everything through 16S, but obviously the advantages of doing whole shotgun metagenomics is that you can get into the functional predictions. So what we end up doing is feature prediction and annotation, and we do that by several methods. We'll first run a pipeline called PROCA, which was designed for annotating bacterial genomes. We also run PFAM and PRINCE and PRODOM and all these sorts of things. So essentially what we're getting for each sample is a table of stuff that's in it. And depending on what the particular question you want to ask, different tables may be more relevant than others. And then once you do that, we can get relative coverage of both the taxonomies and all the functions. And then finally, we basically classify the unclassified reads so that we can at least say something about it. At this point, for the unclassified reads, we only look at it taxonomically because with a short read, you're unlikely to actually have a meaningful amount to identify a function. And then we then search, we've also have a number of specific databases. There's a database of pathogenic genes. It's sort of a nice thing just to say, does this bug or this contig anyway look like a pathogen? And we've got sort of antibiotic resistance genes, and we have a series of databases like that. And then finally, where we basically, it integrates all this data and produces lots of graphs and tells you what's exciting about your data. So again, this is, I've sort of talked about it a bit about, this is just different databases that the program uses. So here's sort of an example of how you can use it for beta diversity. So this was an example where essentially we had basically these knockout mice, and we have these flox mice, which are essentially wild type. And basically what the question was, is the phenotype of the knockout mice sort of transferable to the wild mice? And this is sort of an example, is once you've run each sample with JAMS alpha, then we have now JAMS beta. So what that does is that takes in a metadata sheet. And you could sort of think of it like a spreadsheet. So obviously it tells you your sample, And then it tells you different columns, or tells you which, you know, would be different depending on what project you're working on. But in this case, we have day, we have the number of polyps, we have where the fecal transplant came in, and sometimes we just throw in sort of a random thing like this as sort of a sanity check. In this case, it's planet. It's just randomly associated planet Earth, Vulcan, whatever. The point of this is, if you start seeing anything significant coming from this column, then something is wrong. So basically, then the other features you take in is a sort of description of each of these columns. Obviously, you're saying that sample is a sample, and then we're saying things that are discrete, like okay, so planet in this case is discrete, and we have this idea of subsetable things. So subsetable things is things that we want to then go into and treat separately. So we want to have a separate analysis for each day, for instance, or we want to have a separate analysis for each type of fecal transplant. And then finally, we have this idea of continuous variables like polyps, the number of polyps. So then it actually makes sense to maybe look at some correlations, because you actually have a continuous variable to correlate to. So this is just sort of an example of some of the sort of outputs that you can get. In this case, it's an ordination plot. In this case, it's PCA. We can also do TISNI and all sorts of other fancy things, UMAP. But the point of this is, it's basically saying that that these data cluster by day. And what's kind of neat about this is, it's going to go through all the variables and sort of tell you things. And it also will also run PERMANOVA and tell you, okay, this is actually statistically significant. I mean, and you can sort of tell by eye, but it is sort of nice to have the numbers behind there that, you know, clearly these samples differ by day. And this is just, again, sort of what I was saying. If you look by planet, it's just, you know, not nonsense. So it makes sense that we can sort of have a little more trust that the things that we do see are significant, are meaningful. And another thing it can do is it can create these heat maps. In this case, what this is basically saying is that in this case, I think we've got red is high and blue is low. And so basically what we're seeing here is that there appear to be certain things which are in the flocks, essentially wild type microbiome, which are not in the knockout microbiome. And you can sort of see that sort of nicely is, I mean, we didn't force this. This is sort of unsupervised. So the samples themselves organize in this way. And what's sort of nice is, when you start seeing blocks like this in your heat maps, you know that there probably is a real signal. We've got a couple of other things. We sort of see with polyps, it's sort of hard to tell, but you sort of see there's more polyps here in the knockout than in the essentially wild type. And we've got a couple of other things. We have essentially percentage assembled, which is all in this case pretty consistent. And then we're basically looking for basically gigabytes of non-host aligned data, which is, again, some in this case it doesn't really make a big difference. But in some cases, you may then see particular samples which are, you know, almost entirely host data. And again, we're saying functionality. So in this case, we have, although you can't obviously read these things, the point of this is that these are functions. And some functions are upregulated, and some functions are downregulated. And you can sort of see, again, that the functionality is creating some really nice blocks, which is then sort of suggestive that you can then look at these sorts of things. And again, like the TMA lice that we saw with AL23 story, is these sort of things can really tell you a lot about your data. So, you know, where do we want to go next with this? So again, like I was saying, we want to integrate a 16S pipeline. We want to make it easily installable in any system. Right now, it's sort of set up for this the sort of compute cluster at the NIH, but obviously we want this to be as installable anywhere you can. We need the right documentation, both of the program, and also what's kind of nice is as writing this, we're trying to make the individual functions that say make heat maps and what have you as generic as possible, so then people can then actually use them even if they don't actually use the rest of GEMS. And this other idea is we want to then create some sort of algorithm to deconvolute taxa. This is something that we're sort of playing with right now. We're basically saying, how can we tell if two things are the same organism or different organisms? And one way we're trying to look at it is through quotient bias, actually, is to sort of see, do the sequences tend to cluster one place and another place? Even if they might be related species, there might be enough there to distinguish that they're separate. Another thing what we're looking at is we're looking at average genome length for essentially every taxa, both at the species level and then all the way up the thing into, you know, genus and family and what have you. And one of the things that we can look at is we can then say, if you've got something that looks like it's 2x the size of a typical genome, you probably actually have two separate entities that are there. And then finally, of course, we do need to publish and release this pipeline very soon. So sort of as just sort of the wrap up, I just want to sort of acknowledge my colleagues, first of all, in the Trinkeri lab, obviously Giorgio and John McCulloch, and then a lot of these people who did a lot of lab work. The microbiome core, which does a lot of our sequencing, run by Colm, and then Jane runs a lot of the sequencers. And then we can't forget the people in Frederick who actually have our mice and take care of them. And also our collaborators, the Rerman Lab in NIDDK. Again, with the IL-23 story, that was done with Sergey Grinnikov and his wife, Ekaterina Koltsova. And then they're very talented students, Alia and Julia. So thank you. Any questions?